I don't have to do that at dad's house. At mom's house, she does it all. I don't have to do anything. Mom doesn't make me do that. That's ridiculous. Dad never has us do that. These are some things you're gonna hear when you're divorced. You're in two separate houses and you have two separate rules. No, you don't. Well, you shouldn't. You should have consistency. You should have the same brand coming across, and that is strong parenting. That's the brand you're throwing at your kids, is that together you are one team, but two houses. We are going to tackle how to have a basic set of rules, but yet live in two separate houses. How to co-parent together and raising young kids to teenagers to almost adults and keeping it consistent so that their lives are better, their behaviors are consistent, and teachers appreciate it. Because I will tell you, as a former teacher, teachers know when they were at a certain parent's house the night before. Because typically the child will act out the next day, be sleepy, or just be off with their behavior a little bit. So it's really important for both parents to be on the same page when it comes to house rules and discipline and structure, so the child can excel and have a great education. You are gonna find some awesome value in today's tips on how to co-parent. But if you need more co-parenting tips, don't hesitate to head over to SamanthaBoss.com. You don't want to be the Disney parent. You don't want to be the parent that just allows everything to happen at their house. There's no rules. There's no structure. You're just trying to win over your child. That is a no-no. It's always great at first, after the divorce, to be fun and to do fun things and take on all the responsibility. But you're not teaching your child anything. You're not teaching them consistency and behavior. You're not teaching them to be responsible for themselves. And you're not teaching them to respect your household, which is really important. But I will say, there's always gonna be that one parent that is always the stickler, always the rule follower, always the person that makes the kids follow what they're supposed to do, the responsible parent. And then there will be that one parent that's a little lax, that says they're gonna try, that says they're gonna implement, and just kind of falls through every once in a while. But it's really important to stay on top of each other and really co-parent together and have those conversations consistently about behaviors, about rules, about expectations that are occurring at your house, and ask what is happening at the other house. And if you and your co-parent ever have a disagreement about these things, the first person you should go to is your children's teacher. They are gonna be the first ones to be able to tell you that they are seeing erratic behavior after the child comes from one parent, or sometimes when the child is going to the other parent's house. That day can be a little rough for a teacher because the child is acting out based upon where they're going after school. So talking to your teacher is usually the first and safest step to defuse an argument. The teacher's gonna let you know that they are seeing some inconsistent behaviors. And teachers are not inconsistent. So the child, when they start acting out, there's a definite issue that needs to be addressed at home. So here are some basic rules that need to be consistent between the two households. Number one, bedtime routine. You need to make sure you're doing the same hygiene setup, you have the same type of PJs at each other's houses, you need to make sure you're doing the same bath time, book, what's their bedtime snack? Are they brushing their teeth before they go to bed? What are you doing at mom's house that you need to be doing at dad's house consistently? Getting that bedtime established. You don't have to be the exact same, but within a 30-minute window for the younger kids would be great. As they get older, I'm telling you, raising teens right now, bedtimes are important, so making sure that gets implemented, especially on school nights. The same is true for the second one, the wake-up routine. Are you giving your child enough time to be successful in the morning? Are they getting their chores done in the morning? Are they taking care of themselves? Are they getting a shower in? And making sure that they eat breakfast, if that is what they consistently do at both houses. Making sure you have options to where your child is completely successful in the morning, but it's consistent with both households. The third one, after-school routine. Are you having chores at your house? Does the other parent have chores? Do you have a homework set up? Is there someone there to greet them when they come home? Or are they home by themselves for a few hours and you're checking in with your phone? Making sure that at each house, your child has resources for food, they have their chores to do, they know who to check in with, there's emergency contacts, and just establishing a consistent routine after school. They may be in a sport and need to be picked up. Making sure that no one's dropping the ball on that, you're staying consistent with calendars, checking in with one another so that your child is always picked up and dropped off on time after school. The next one is food, and this is one where the ball gets dropped a lot. As co-parents, you have to make sure you know what you're feeding your child. Are you feeding them the same consistent things at both houses? They're getting their breakfast, lunch, snacks, and dinner. Are they getting good quality food at each house? It's really difficult on a child's stomach, and behavior issues can come about if at one house they're getting a good solid meal of eggs and toast, or the next day at the other parent's house they're getting just a basic sugar cereal or no breakfast at all. So being consistent with what you pack in their lunches, are they basically eating the same thing throughout the day? Because you don't want to be messing with a child's stomach. Making sure that at one house they don't eat 16 snacks before dinner, where at the other house they get none. Be consistent. Talk to each other about what you're doing for your child's snack and food habits. And what are they drinking? At one household, water and milk might be all that's available. At the other household, they may have an ample supply of pops and Kool-Aids and sugary drinks. So having that discussion of, at my house, this is what's happening at your house, so could we limit somehow meet in the middle? The last one's a doozy, and this is where the Disney parent usually comes about, is having screen time control between the two houses. Whether that be that you are giving your child an iPad or a computer to play with or a phone, versus maybe that's not allowed at the other house, or the child brings it from your house to the other house. Making sure that you're communicating. How much screen time is too much screen time? What apps are they allowed to go on? Who are they allowed to talk to? Who are they talking to? What conversations are they having? This is where co-parenting needs to have a really big conversation. You guys have to be on the same page with this. One parent can't allow the child to have free rein of the iPad while the other parent is scrutinizing every little app that they go on to and looking at every conversation they're having. So make sure you respect each other enough to talk about the dangers of having too much technology time and screen time, and limit those and have a conversation to where it's on the same page. You want to make sure you're protecting your children from outside sources, but also allowing them some freedoms, but it's got to be consistent between the two houses. At the end of the day, both co-parents can do what they want in each house. I understand that, and I know you understand that, but the bottom line is your children have to have consistency throughout their parenting, and that also comes from teachers as well. So if the teachers have them for 8 hours a day and it's giving them consistency, then you as parents, for that 4 to 5 hour window on each side of the day, have to really try your hardest to make it consistent for the child, because we all know, and speaking from experience as a teacher, when a child receives inconsistent parenting and teaching, their behaviors are going to be inconsistent. And that's going to be very difficult to deal with when co-parenting. So make sure you're on the same page. This might not be a conversation that you have right away as soon as you're divorced, but after you've given it some time, a few months, you really need to jump in there, have that sit down at the table, have a conversation, establish some basic rules at each house that you agree to follow, and implement your own twist. You can have more chores at your house, or maybe you allow 30 more minutes of screen time, but you at least have some type of dialogue to where you're on the same page. Meet in the middle. If one parent feels like they should be able to have 6 snacks and you think 2, meet in the middle with that. If you think you should have 3 hours of screen time and you think 1, meet in the middle of that. Have some give and take, negotiate it down, but be consistent on what you're presenting to your child. If you have found value in today's video, please go ahead and hit that subscribe button, give me a thumbs up, and leave a comment below. I would love to hear some co-parenting tips that you've implemented that have worked for you, but I have more. If you head over to SamanthaBoss.com, you are gonna get a ton of co-parenting free tips. Just go to my website, SamanthaBoss.com, and take advantage of those free downloads.